Oh my gosh. Holy cow. Brutal brain injuries, extreme facial reconstruction, and that doesn't seem compatible with life. Today, we are breaking down all of these spine-shattering medical scenes and simulated injuries of ballistic gels. Let's dive right in.
What it looks like when a high explosive rocket impacts a person.
Oh my gosh. Okay, this looks to be like an RPG.
I love it.
These are high explosive RPG-7 projectiles. We've got this mounted to a nice sturdy base, and then we're gonna run the string back. Yep, very long remote pull string for ultimate safety, and that's going to launch the rocket.
Of what I know, I believe these are like anti-tank missiles. I don't believe it's actually even made for soft targets. We're shooting helicopters and buildings. I don't think the torso stand a chance.
Body parts going over the freaking dirt. That's
yes.
That's a brain. Skull. You got the skull. I got the brain. All right, here you go.
Okay.
Nice.
Okay.
Traumatic brain injury, missing piece of skull, maybe some brain. They may not be long for the world, but they're still breathing on their own. You gotta have to help them. If somebody came straight to the hospital, see how the cardiovascular system is doing, is the heart beating well, and then they probably pretty much just need to go to the operating room.
What happened to this guy? He's still intact.
Oh, his head is kind of off.
This smells familiar.
Oh.
I don't think he made it.
Well, his lung is gone.
The left lung looks okay, but the right lung might not be functioning. Can you put a chest tube in that? No, it's open. Not functioning at this current time. Bulky dressing, a lot of compression to get that to stop bleeding. And hopefully the left lung is sustaining this person's life. I mean, the slow-mo is cool.
Oh, he's gone.
Yeah, he's gone. Of course he's gone. We all knew the first torso had no chance, but here you see that the RPG caused enough destruction of the initial impact to cause secondary injuries to the second torso.
So we just tenfolded our frame rate from the last shot to this.
Going right into the lung there. Also, stomach is sitting right there as well as liver.
Whoa! Oh, he is so done.
Shockwave on the back side of the wall? Yeah,
so the explosion punched through the cinder block.
Yeah, and I wonder if it actually detonated like.
How cool is that? You can actually see the shockwave. We're worried about in medicine, that compressive force causing you to have your eardrums rupture, you potentially popping lungs and issues with like different hollow organs. It's real and you can actually see it with your own two eyes here.
Yeah, remember when we looked at his body, there was a huge chunk in his chest. Oh, he's done.
Oh, yeah.
That one went in.
Ooh, he's so smart.
That's worse than what he looked
done.
Like.
There's a rib. That's going into your flesh and digging into your skull.
It gives us a look into when people get hit with shrapnel, cause significant amount of trauma and probably end of life or not compatible with life. You're having a lot of soft tissue injury. You're having embedded pieces of concrete sticking into your tissues. They're all treated like foreign bodies. You need to get them out if you can.
And the explosion's still not done. So crazy.
When bullets hit a human body and then they stay inside, we don't go after them because it can cause more destruction. Same idea with these foreign pieces. We try to get them out, but at a certain point, the amount of trauma and tissue damage that you're going to occur because you're trying to get them out is greater than just leaving them there.
You definitely want something between you and a rocket.
Yes.
Battlefield situation, what the heck do you do? Airway breathing circulation, you're gonna be worried that somebody's gonna lose an airway or not be able to breathe well. So you're gonna put it in an ET tube or some sort of device to help the individual breathe.
So this is military grade C4. We have 4.25 pounds of it.
C4 is a type of plastic explosive.
That is C4 explosive.
Generates a lot of heat because it's plastic, so it ignites super fast and then a big blast.
We're gonna put all of it in there and we're gonna put it on our little friend here. Might get some ribs flying into that guy. This guy might get enough of the disruptive concussive wave that his bones get shattered inside of him.
The ribs potentially would be in pieces. So it just depends on the amount of trauma. Do you typically do surgery on the ribs? No, but unless they're massively displaced causing issues, then you can actually do surgery. Ribs take a very long time to heal because you're always moving your chest to breathe. So it's a slower process. Oh my gosh. Holy cow.
His whole head is hemorrhaged on the inside. His head split in half.
I mean, the concussion hemorrhaged his brain.
That's in half. Yeah.
If there's enough trauma going on to the brain, you can actually rip your bridging veins, causing a subdural hemorrhage. And if you have trauma to the side of the head, you can cause an epidural hematoma or hemorrhage, and then subarachnoids as well as intraparenchymals.
For sure, the pressure collapses lungs.
When it comes to your lungs, you can have hemothorax and pneumothorax, broken ribs because of the force, pulmonary contusions, basically bruising of the lungs. And bruise doesn't seem so bad, but actually the blood accumulates within the lung tissue and makes that part of the lung basically useless for gas exchange.
He's done. Organs are smushed.
The other hollow things that we have in our body are the GI tract, and you can rupture that open. You can have significant bruising, swelling. You can have delayed peritonitis, inflammation of those areas.
That's him. That's ground zero. Oh, he's gone. That's why we didn't find him. He is scattered into the field.
You're having flames and fire force behind it, causing heat type, burn type injuries, and then getting thrown, and whatever happens as you fly through the air and land on something, head injuries, concussions, contusions, fractures, dislocations, those sorts of things.
We're gonna find out just how effective a crossbow would be against a stock.
Oh my gosh. Whoa, just gone straight through. Left lung getting hit, probably pull it all the way through, get it out of there. And then there's gonna be injury to the lung itself that might need surgery. The lung will have collapsed most likely, and there'll be bleeding and air on the outside of that lung within the thoracic cavity.
It's right here. It is wadded up out the back, just barely hanging out. We hit that rib and broke it. And you can see it just barely clipped the shoulder blade and broke it.
Injury to the rib and the scapula. The rib, again, not much to do, a single fracture on the front, it will heal on its own. When a scapula is actually injured, you always have to have a high degree of suspicion that there's another injury somewhere, because it takes a lot of force to break a piece of your scapula.
Lodged in the zombie's rib and lung, and then it came through the back here. You can see that it shattered that shoulder blade.
Do you do anything with the scapula? Unlikely in that scenario. You don't see a lot of destroyed scapulas, but you're more worried about the underlying issue of, okay, you have a lot of lung trauma and bleeding that needed to fix, because that is more life-threatening in the immediate. Ooh. It's really interesting. So the attachment of your ribs to your sternum right here on either side is a lot of cartilage. People will sometimes get something called costochondritis, which is inflammation of the cartilage.
So I purposely aimed more towards the center because I wanted to encounter more bone, and it really didn't seem to matter. We hit this rib and part of the sternum.
Hitting centrally in the chest like that, you worry about rupturing the aorta or top of the heart itself, which then can cause to succumb to the injury pretty darn fast.
I'm really curious to see what a mechanical broadhead will do when we hit the zombie in the dome.
In the dome, oh my gosh. Arrows to the brain, to the dome, unlikely survivable because of the amount of bleeding, swelling, and trauma that it causes. But if you miss the heart and it's just a lung injury or soft tissue injury, these most likely are going to be survivable. Again, always depends.
What would happen if you threw caution to the wind and kissed your true love?
Oh my gosh.
A 60,000 PSI water jet. Or clean your teeth really well.
Badness. Doing any kind of high risk or precision work, whether it's tactical, medical, or mechanical, means your mind has to be sharp and focused. That's why I created a Level Up from Life Happens for steady, crash-free alertness. Check it out at lifehappens.com or Amazon.
A ear pierce test and maybe a little French kiss test? That's nasty.
If you're just getting the injury to the tip of the tongue, you're probably going to be fine. But if you're having it severed halfway down, then the likelihood of you being able to articulate or speak well is going to be significantly impaired. Well, gone.
Well,
I don't know about that one, Chief.
We got delipitated.
Delipitated.
Oh,
yeah, almost like a laceration straight through. Lips do get lacerated, not just from water jets. You really have to put back what's called the vermilion border, and you have to get it perfectly because that is what gives us symmetry.
Many cuts here to the chin.
Be careful.
Don't you hurt yourself. Giving him the London look.
Classic, just lacerations, potential fractures, which are repairable. But then the biggest thing is if it goes in your mouth, then it can actually cause severe destruction or airway compromise.
Okay, this is a little bit of a better angle. Right between the teeth. Oh, whoa. Oh, that's what the tongue did. That's how it got all tangled up like that.
If the tongue gets lacerated like this, tongues bleed a ton. You have to get control of that. A lot of times getting control of the tongue is hard if somebody's awake, because kind of like our involuntary, voluntary organ that we move around a lot, or muscle that we move around a lot.
Should be fun.
What?
Oh, that got some damage.
Usually we see these type of injuries at the hospital where somebody might be pushing a piece of wood into the table saw and catch a thumb and amputate the thumb off, or fingers. And very rarely do you see like an arm. Most of the time it's fingers. Because it's a table saw, it's a much finer cut. There's a potential of reattachment.
In a way, most saws are removing some material, but none remove material like a chainsaw. It's not just slicing it nice and neat like a bandsaw. It is literally hogging out and removing that flesh and bone along with any wood or anything else that gets in the way.
When somebody comes to the emergency department with chainsaw injuries, could be disastrous, or they are massive amounts of flesh wounds. I've seen people who have scalped themselves. I've seen individuals where they've almost amputated arms and legs off.
There are parts of Europe that require people to go through special training just to use one, or a license. You could imagine how Americans would take that if you try to take our chainsaws, because even though I am dangerously underqualified and really don't know how to use it, I will have a Ruby Ridge standoff if anybody comes for my chainsaw.
A lot of times the issue ends up being the chainsaw in and of itself is ripping tissue away. When the injury is over, how do I close this wound? Because you're having a gap and you're missing tissue. The amount of potential infection that also goes in with this is high, because it's ripping, pulling, and it's not a very clean object. It is good to have these ballistic injuries because it shows the potential of injuries that could happen. Just be careful out there. If you guys enjoyed this Ballistics React and you want to see more, let me know in the comments. And as always, definitely check out this playlist right here. Binge watch it all for me. And subscribe, turn on your bell notifications, and hit that like button for me. Thank you so much for watching, and stay healthy, my friends.